I'd like to welcome you here to UC Irvine, to the Beckman Center, on behalf of the School of Law and the School of Social Ecology and the Newkirk Center for Science and Society, to our conference on pesticides, domestic and international perspective from science, law, and governance. We have an interesting and wide-ranging program over the next few days. I hope that you're all as excited about it as we are here. We're going to talk about pesticide science all the way from the science over the next few days, that much of the controversy comes from the fact that policymakers are not really aware of how good the science is. And we're going to start that tonight with Pete Myers. So it's a very great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Pete Myers, from Environmental Health Sciences. Pete received a bachelor's degree from Reed College and a Ph.D. from our neighbors up north, UC Berkeley. For a number of years, he was the director of the W. Alton Jones Foundation, where he was a tireless advocate, both supporting the science and the policy to advance the field of environmental health sciences. After he left the Jones Foundation, Pete founded Environmental Health Sciences, where he was and continues to serve as the CEO. And Environmental Health Sciences publishes several important daily journals, if you will, the Environmental Health News and also Daily Climate, which is a very important source of up-to-the-minute news about these important fields. So Pete has also chaired the board of the Science Communication Network since its founding in 2003, and this is a very kind of quiet organization that's been working behind the scenes to make sure that journalists get the science right. And I think that the recent discussion about BPA in the news is a very good example of how well Science Communications Network is doing at getting the science out to the communicators of that to the public. Pete has served on and chaired the boards of a number of foundations, and the one I'm going to pick to mention is the John Hines Center for Science, Economics, and the Environment. And I'm happy to report that Pete was elected as the chairman of the board just a few weeks ago of that very important organization, and the vice chair is Teresa Hines. Perhaps many of us best know Pete from the seminal book, Our Stolen Future, that he wrote together with Theo Kohlborn and Diane Dumanowski. That's certainly the first place that I ever heard Pete's name. And Our Stolen Future was very important because it changed the debate about chemicals. Prior to that, after Silent Spring, we had all heard that environmental chemicals cause cancer. And cancer is, of course, extraordinarily scary, but I would argue that it's not particularly dangerous for our species as a whole. Where Our Stolen Future talks about the effect of endocrine disrupting chemicals on our ability to reproduce and on the potential effects of this on the future of mankind. So since then, Pete's done many things. He's been recently the co-author of a paper on low-dose effects of chemicals, which summarizes the very voluminous science on the low-dose and non-monotonic effects of environmental chemicals. And perhaps this is an area of some controversy which we hear, but the fact is that low-dose and non-monotonic effects are absolutely expected from the endocrinology and the physiology of the chemical. So it's not a surprise. It's exactly what we expect. And unfortunately, not everyone in the toxicology community believes that. And we need to convince them of the quality of the science. By way of an anecdote, the first time I met Pete was in Japan at a meeting in Kobe in probably 2000. And his talk followed the talk of an industry apologist who shall remain nameless, who attacked in a very unscientific way the science of one of the leading people in the endocrine disruptor field. And Pete started his talk by referring to the tobacco lawyer that had preceded him and then laying out the actual science and how high quality and how much of the science there was that disputed what the tobacco lawyer was talking about. So the last thing I'll say about Pete is perhaps one of the most important, and that's that I consider him to be a visionary in a time when that species is almost extinct. So Pete had the foresight to realize that it's going to be a very difficult battle to get the regulatory organizations one by one to ban or restrict the use of a variety of endocrine disrupting chemicals. So Pete thought out of the box, and he had the idea that We ought to link people in the environmental health science community with the emerging field of green chemistry, which seeks to design chemicals that are safe from the beginning. And Pete, together with Karen O'Brien from Advancing Green Chemistry, are leading the effort to link environmental health scientists with green chemists so that we can help them to design a set of screening protocols that will enable chemists to know from the beginning whether their chemicals are likely to be endocrine disruptors or not. Therefore, we can provide the marketplace with safe chemicals from the beginning. And I think that that's a very important thing that Pete's led the effort for, and that effort began in this room 5 years ago. So I'm happy to say that UC Irvine participated in that. So I'd especially like to thank Pete for being here. He gave a talk in Washington at 9 o'clock this morning and hopped on a plane to be here, so it's been a long day for him. And thank you, Pete. I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say.
Good evening, and thank you for coming here this evening. I will touch on a number of the things that Bruce mentioned that we're working on, and I want to definitely acknowledge that Karen O'Brien, the head of Advancing Green Chemistry, has been a complete partner in the last issue that you mentioned. Part of the inspiration for doing it came out of her and her experience in green chemistry. I want to begin with a series of questions, and I would appreciate it if you would raise your hand if the answer is yes. I'd like you to think about your family and your close friends, and think among them, have any of them experienced prostate cancer? Hold your hands high. Okay. What about breast cancer? What about ADHD? What about type 2 diabetes? One last question. If you put your hand up at least once, put it up again, please, and look around. These are today's epidemics. We just learned, for example, last week that autism is now hitting 1 out of 88 children in the US, 1 out of 49 boys. These are unprecedented epidemics in this country, and it doesn't have to be. We're learning enough out of a revolution in the environmental health sciences is revealing opportunities to prevent diseases that we didn't know were preventable just 10 or 15 years ago. But the work of people like Bruce and Tyrone Hayes that are getting into detailed molecular mechanisms of how some of these diseases are caused, they give us hope that policies driven by that science, but also choices made by chemists about how they can design their materials in new ways that avoid some of the molecular mechanisms that lead to health issues. That revolution in science that I'm going to talk about this evening provides, for me, great hope about what the future of American health might look like, not just American health, but world health. And what I'd like to do is tell some stories about endocrine disruption as a science, where it came from, what some of the important issues that have arisen in it are. But I thought that I'd make some opening comments by going back to Thomas Kuhn's book on the structure of scientific revolutions. Now, this was a book that I read avidly when I was a student at Reed College in the late 60s. It was written in the early 60s. Have any of you read Thomas Kuhn's book? I certainly hope that they're teaching that book here today, somewhere on campus. It's about the structure of scientific revolutions. What happens? How do they happen? What makes them, what slows them down and what speeds them up? And the reason why I want to focus on this initially is because we are living today in a revolution in the environmental health sciences. And it, for a scientist there at this time to be experiencing this is really exciting. Like any revolution, be it scientific or physical, it's rife with skirmishes, with trench warfare, all-out battle. Scientific revolutions don't happen overnight. Typically, they sneak up on the scientific community as different scientists begin to throw bricks at the old paradigm. bricks from very different directions. Evidence that contradicts the conventional scientific wisdom is usually ignored when it first starts to come in. In fact, sometimes it's ridiculed. That just can't be true. At first, those bricks have no discernible impact. They are seen as anomalies, sometimes even as the exceptions that prove the rule. But trouble starts for the paradigm when the argument becomes the data can't be real. They don't fit the existing paradigm. That's when you know there's something wrong with the science, because data don't have to fit theory. Theory has to fit data. So over time, the anomalies, those bricks, mount. They become a force. The weight of evidence from many different sources becomes so heavy that the wall collapses. Some defenders of the existing paradigm dig in, and they cling to their belief structure, even in the face of overwhelming, compelling evidence, unwilling to acknowledge that a tectonic shift in their field has taken place. Max Planck talked about this in the mid-20th century. He said, when these revolutions are going on, you don't win by the force of your ideas. You win because your opponents die. That's how tough these battles can be. There have been many participants pushing this revolution in the environmental health sciences forward. And each of them will have their own idiosyncratic perspective on what were the key issues, what happened. I've got mine, and I'm going to share some stories about that tonight. Rather than overload you with data, I will have some data, but I thought if I structured this as a series of stories about how this field developed and where it's going, it might be more fun. Before we get to the stories, though, I do want to quickly summarize for you what I identify as the key elements of that scientific revolution that's underway. It involves profound changes in how we think about links between contamination and health, including things like chronic diseases in adulthood. It includes unexpected discoveries about products that we've let into our households that we thought were safe by traditional standards, but now we're not quite so sure. How many of you have heard of bisphenol A, BPA? That's one of those things we let into our household. The FDA announced at the end of March, well, we can't tell you it's safe, but we don't have enough evidence to ban it yet. So there's an ongoing battle there over that particular compound, and there are many others like it. Many of these battles are playing out in the marketplace as consumers say, hey, I don't want to be a chemical engineer to go shopping for my kids, but that's the only choice I have right now. For me, the most important part of this is it is opening up, as I mentioned early on, dramatic opportunities for prevention. We can make people healthier. We can help them avoid disease. There are six key discoveries at 30,000 feet in this revolution. One is that contaminants are interacting with genes in ways that aren't reflected in the current testing methods used to ask what's safe and what's not. These interactions can take place at extremely low concentrations, part per billion certainly. In some cases, we've got good data for certain compounds, including bisphenol A, at subparts per trillion. Exposures in the womb set in motion processes that play out over a lifetime. And these biological events, the development of the fetus and how it moves through life and ages, either well or poorly, those sorts of considerations were virtually ignored by traditional toxicological questions asking about, is this safe or is this not? And I'll show you one example of that, one of the few data slides I'm going to have. The exposures are ubiquitous because of the way we use materials and chemicals. And they come in mixtures. They're not by themselves. And yet all the ways that regulatory toxicology asks questions about what's safe and what is not do their tests singly, one at a time. I'll spend a little bit more time on this one. The traditional tools, the epidemiology and regulatory toxicological approaches we have used to assess risk are blind to some of these effects. I'll show you some very specific examples about that. But for me, following what Bruce said, There's a whole flip side to this. We know enough now about a lot of the molecular mechanisms driving the ways that contaminants affect health. That information can become design signals from this revolution in science that guide the innovative development of new materials that are inherently vastly safer than things we currently have available, because those questions were not asked well as the prior generation of materials was developed. So that's the six pillars of this revolution. And I said I would show you one data slide. It's been long enough since dinner that I hope I can share with you the inside of a mouse. Is that socially acceptable here? OK. This is a control mouse. I'm going to compare it to the treatment group momentarily. But I want you to look at its kidneys. They're looking healthy. It's got a small bladder. It's a male. It has testes. It's about my age in mouse years. So been around a while. That's the control animal. What would have happened, do you think, if it had been exposed to 20 parts per billion via water to its mother while it was pregnant? 20 parts per billion bisphenol A. So the bladder is about to explode. If the animal had been allowed to live a few more days, it probably would have exploded. The kidneys have grown necrotic. They don't work anymore. Testes are still okay, at least in this animal. What happened? Well, the scientists who do this work at the University of Missouri have discovered that there's a collection of, there's a piece of tissue in the urethra of the animal. Now, the urethra is that tube that connects the bladder to the outside world. It's what the mouse and we pee through, right? Okay, so there's this tissue at some point along the urethra that responds to changes in the aging mouse if it's been exposed to bisphenol A in the womb differently than the control animal. And gradually, what happens is the urethra constricts and ultimately is completely blocked, and it can no longer pee. That unfolds over the lifetime of the animal. It's not visible at birth unless you use highly advanced molecular genetic tools to detect the epigenetic changes that have taken place in that tissue. So this is the sort of result that never would have been discovered using traditional toxicological tools. But you bring modern molecular genetics into the picture, you start asking sophisticated questions in the world's most advanced laboratories, and you find things that are sobering. When did this start, this revolution in the environmental health sciences? Well, certainly by the 1930s, there were scientific signals that showing that some chemicals could behave like hormones or interfere with their action, a process that Bruce referred to called endocrine disruption, disrupting the hormone system. In Silent Spring in 1962, Rachel Carson wrote about some research that had already been discovered back then that also hinted at what might be happening out in the real world. Then in the 1970s, a wave of research built around the discovery that a synthetic hormone called diethylstilbestrol, or DES, a synthetic estrogen, that was being used in theory to manage difficult pregnancies, turns out it didn't work, that exposure in the womb caused young women, as they moved in the age of 17, 18, 19, to develop an extremely rare cancer that heretofore was only known in much older women. Work by endocrinologists like Howard Byrne at UC Berkeley and John McLaughlin at the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, along with a team of physicians and epidemiologists led by Arthur Herbst, who was the guy who actually made the serendipitous discovery linking exposure in the womb to cancer at the age of 18, they dove into and discovered and drove the science revealing the astonishing vulnerability of the developing fetus to chemical perturbations and the lifelong impacts that that could have. That was really That's where the origins of what's now referred to as fetal origins of adult disease came from. In the 1970s, McLaughlin from NIHS even organized a series of unprecedented seminars on estrogens in the environment, clearly demonstrating in those seminars that this phenomenon, endocrine disruption, was not limited to diethylstilbestrol, DES. During that era, much of the debate was about estrogens, about and estrogen-like compounds. Few people working then had a clue, any clue, as to how much bigger and broader it would become as an issue. Now we know in principle that virtually any of our body's hormone signaling systems are vulnerable to disruption. It's only a question of who has the time and the resources to do the experiments to confirm that reality. For example, then the notion that in endocrine disrupting compounds, EDCs, might cause obesity by affecting stem cell differentiation, they would have been met with total disbelief. Are you crazy? We didn't have the scientific construction, this constructs back then to think about it. The molecular pathways weren't known and probably weren't even imaginable. It took brilliant research by Bruce Blumberg here at UC Irvine to open up the study of what he has aptly called obesogens. The first brick that I saw thrown at that wall of old toxicology, I witnessed when I was a graduate student at Berkeley. A man named Michael Fry at UC Davis showed in the early 70s that male western gulls, you know, the bird that breeds along the coast here, male western gulls exposed as embryos to DDE, a relative of DDT, became partially feminized as a result of the exposure, and he made the case that this could be the cause of widespread female-female pairing that was occurring in western gull breeding populations on the Channel Islands. I was a graduate student, as I said, at Berkeley at the time. I got to meet Fry in seminars. I was fascinated by it, but lacked then the competence to understand it. And it was a very early brick with a lot of pushback from people who didn't accept the science or didn't want to see it accepted. I went off and did other things for 15 years until I got hit by a force of nature. At the time, I was in a very different field. I was a research ornithologist, believe it or not. Really. I studied the field ecology of birds. In fact, I was the world expert on a species called the sanderling, which you have along the coast here, which breeds in the Arctic and migrates to sandy beaches throughout the Western Hemisphere during the winter. These are the ghostly sanderling on a Peruvian beach right at sunset. They're the white birds you, when you're down at the beach, they're running up and down in front of the waves. While there are a lot of sanderling in California, we discovered that the mecca for this species in the winter, when they're not breeding, is the desert coast of Peru and northern Chile, which gave me a professional excuse to visit any tropical beach in the Western Hemisphere. And based in Philadelphia, I abused that opportunity shamelessly. I mean, who wants to be in Philadelphia in January? I got paid to do this. I had research funding. It was a great time. Year after year, I got to go to Peru and Chile, studying some of the basic biology of these birds, charting their migration routes from Chile and Peru up to the Arctic. We had one bird that we banded in Chile. We put unique color band combinations on them so we could tell exactly who it was when we saw them later. We had one bird banded in Chile, seen at the mouth of the Columbia River on the Pacific coast and in spring migration, and then seen on Cape Cod in fall migration. The same bird, making this vast circumcontinental loop. What you can do now with satellite technology and what they've learned, you know, I was doing this 25 years ago, it's just extraordinary, the sort of detail that's available on these migration patterns now, which we were just wondering about and beginning to get some hint. It was much more complicated than anyone imagined. So that's what I was doing then. But in those years, when I was down there, sanderlings, that species, were undergoing a precipitous decline by one estimate, about 90% over a decade. My research began to switch from the basic intellectual stuff that had no practical implications to asking, what's happening? I want you to picture the desert coast of Peru. It's one of the few places in the world I'm a competent botanist because there may be three species of native plant. Okay? I loved it. Long sandy beaches in Peru, 20, 25 kilometers long, are cut by river gorges that are coming, carrying glacial meltwater down to the Pacific Ocean. That water means that the valleys are heavily irrigated. The irrigation means crops, and the crops means pesticides. As I would be moving down the coast doing my research, I could always tell I was coming close to one of these irrigated valleys because I could smell the pesticides long before I actually got there. I began to collaborate with some toxicologists to explore what role these chemicals might be playing in the sanderling decline. Here was our hypothesis. As I mentioned, sanderlings migrate from Chile to the Arctic and then back. As they're getting ready for migration, they double their weight, literally, over a matter of a few weeks. They build up great masses of body fat to do that. Then when they leave on migration, they fly several days nonstop, and they burn all that energy they stored. Many of the common pesticides in use in these valleys are lipophilic. They like fat, and they concentrate in it. So if a sanderling had been eating a pesticide-laden food, its fat would contain significant amounts of pesticides, which we confirmed. So what happens when the birds migrate and they burn the fat? The pesticides are liberated into the serum. It circulates through the bird's body and concentrates in one of the largest remaining lipid reserves in the body, which is the brain. We hypothesized that if this was not outright deadly, that it could be perhaps disrupting for orientation during migration. So, what about the force of nature that I mentioned? I was lecturing in the Washington, D.C. area, and I described this idea during my comments. It was interesting, at least remotely plausible, but a lot of difficult science lay ahead. We were pushing the limits on what people knew about how contaminants might affect orientation. In fact, nothing was known at the time, I'd learned, about how the development of the migration orientation is driven by hormones. No one knew. So I was lecturing there, I finished, and out of the back of the audience came roaring up this woman I'd never seen before and said, "Pete, we have to work together. Wait till you hear what I've been finding about what's happening in the Great Lakes. It's not cancers those chemicals are causing, for the most part, it's messing with their hormones." That's how I met Theo Kolborn, my co-author with Our Stolen Future. She subsequently joined me when I became director of the W. Alton Jones Foundation and spent time there as a senior fellow. That moment, "Pete, we have to work together," led to a famous conference at the origins of the endocrine disruption science at Wingspread in 1991, where the term endocrine disruptor was actually coined. It led to Our Stolen Future, the book that she and Diane and I published in 1996. And most importantly, from my perspective, the public attention that the book brought to this scientific issue helped create momentum that brought literally hundreds of millions of dollars for research out of government agencies around the world to focus on this suite of issues. And it is that investment in research that has contributed mightily to the revolution we are now witnessing. We were a bestseller in Japan. I found myself, middle-class guy from Baltimore, meeting privately with the emperor. Pretty awesome. I tell you stories about how when you're with the empress, you eat cherries that have pits in them. Do that some other time. Things I never thought I'd know. Probably the most important thing that happened with that funding is that it enabled a wide range of biologists who were not traditional toxicologists to begin asking questions that never would have been asked otherwise. These people like Bruce came out of molecular genetics, like Fred von Saal, a developmental biologist with remarkable knowledge of how natural hormones work, no initial interest in toxicology, but all of a sudden he realized there were compounds in the environment that were behaving like hormones, and his knowledge was essential to begin to ask, what are they doing? Like Pat Hunt, a geneticist who works on how failures in the ways that chromosomes separate during meiosis, during cell division, how those failures, which are the biggest known source of miscarriage in people, might be linked to endocrine-disrupting compounds. And Tyrone Hayes, whose extraordinary work on atrazine and frog development has revealed effects completely unpredicted by the old toxicology. These scientists, not just the ones I've mentioned, but hundreds if not thousands of others, funded by the NIH and operating at the highest scientific levels in the world, brought new skills, new knowledge, new questions, and new insights into the question, what can happen when a chemical behaves like a hormone? Very little of this was traditional toxicology, and especially none of it was being used to guide tests that were being used by the regulatory agencies to determine what's safe and what's not for people, and thus the revolution. This brings me to my second story. When Theo and Diane and I were writing Our Stolen Future, we invited three giants in this field, Fred von Saal, whom I've mentioned, Lou Gillette, and Shauna Swan, to a retreat for several days in Sun Valley. We wanted to suck everything out of their brains we possibly could. Fred was showing me one afternoon, he and I were looking at some data they had, and he was showing me some unpublished data that frankly looked weird. It was a graph showing how as you increase the dose of bisphenol A, like that, what happens to the weight of the prostate in a young mouse that's been exposed in the womb. And the way it looked like was it inverted U. As dose increased for a while, the response increased. But then as dose got higher, the response went back down. I looked at that and knew that it was impossible. Those data couldn't be real. Because, well, the dose makes the poison. That was the conventional wisdom. If those data were real, then regulatory toxicology, what we have counted on to protect us from what's not safe, would be turned on its head completely. I told him that. He said, that's ridiculous. Fred always uses words like ridiculous. He said, this is basic endocrinology. You learn it in your first year classes. Hormones do different things at different doses. What happens at a high dose can be very different from what happens at low doses. High doses can even cause the opposite effect that low doses cause. But I told him, Fred, that contradicts basic assumptions in toxicology that underpin all regulations that have been set in place in the last 50 years. And he looks at me, how could that be? That's so idiotic. He uses a word like that. So let me show you an example. Let's use some pictures instead of graphs. This is an experiment done by Rita Newbold at the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. And you see on your left the control animal, a representative of the control group, and on your right, a representative of the experimental group. They were monitored throughout, first of all, they're the same strain of mouse. They were monitored as they grew up. They had no statistical difference in their caloric intake rate, and similarly, none in their activity levels. But obviously, there's a difference between the controls and the experimentals. The experimentals are grotesquely obese. What happened? Well, it turns out that, remember diethylstilbestrol? I mentioned it way early on. The experimental animal was exposed to one part per billion right at birth, and it changed the way the animal grew completely, put it on a completely different growth trajectory. And Bruce's research has helped us understand why some of this happens. It has to do with a couple different mechanisms. Sometimes some of the chemicals that he calls obesogens can increase the number of fat cells that an animal winds up with, and sometimes it makes those fat cells bigger, but both of them wind up leading to grotesque obesity. Counterintuitively, if you expose the animal to a 1,000-fold higher level of diethylstilbestrol, it would have been scrawny compared to the controls, okay? Basically, it's because the animal is sick. High levels cause disease. Low levels turn on genes that otherwise wouldn't have been turned on. Very different things happen at different parts of the dose response curve. So, and lastly, this is clearly a developmental exposure leading to adult obesity. Low levels matter. High level tests don't predict low level effects. Early life exposures can impair adult health. So that conversation with Fred, oh, this is ridiculous, has continued for the last 20 years. As scientists began looking at more and more endocrine-disrupting compounds using the sophisticated tools that molecular genetics and modern health science have made available to us, these types of effects have been seen with increasing commonness. Technically, the term that's of art that's used is it's a non-monotonic dose response curve, and if I fall into that jargon, please forgive me. Traditional toxicologists have responded basically by saying that that can't be true, the dose makes the poison. At the beginning, they would challenge, and not just at the beginning, but they have for a long time challenged the legitimacy of the work, call the results aberrations, ridicule the science. Papers would be rejected if they had non-monotonic patterns in the dose response curves simply because they're impossible. The dose, we all know, the dose makes the poison. I remember being at a meeting with an FDA scientist not that long ago talking about this, and she said, well, we know they can't be real. We don't see them in our labs. And I pointed out to her, wait a second, you don't test in the dose ranges where these things occur. You test at high doses. You don't test in the low dose range where hormones are turning genes on. You test at the high dose range where hormones are overtly toxic. So a group of us, 12 all told, decided this drip, drip, drip of one isolated example of non-monotonicity after another wasn't going to hack it. We had to step back and do a massive review of the literature on this, finding as many examples as we could find, documenting what's known about the mechanisms by which they happen, looking at the human data and finding human epidemiological data supportive of non-monotonicity. We published this just last month, 840 references, and it's moved the battle over this to a whole new level. Here is what, these are some examples of non-monotonic dose response curves. And the key thing for you mathematicians out there is that the slope of the curve changes sign from negative or positive or back again somewhere along the dose range. Okay? These are standard in endocrinology. These are some of the examples that began to emerge in the 90s and 2000s. And then we did our review. Here is an image of the title, this reference. And here's what the director of the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences wrote about our review shortly after it was published. The question, this is the chief environmental health scientist of the U.S., Linda Birnbaum. The question is no longer whether non-monotonic dose responses are real and whether they occur frequently enough to be a concern. Clearly, these are common phenomena with well-understood mechanisms. So this is not fringe science. And it's a challenge that we're now engaging with the FDA and the EPA and actually regulatory agencies around the world to try and see how do we move forward from here. In fact, the German EPA has offered 50,000 euros to sponsor a meeting with the authors and agency officials from around Europe to sit down, let them take their best shots, see how we do. And frankly, this is basic endocrinology. If you acknowledge endocrinological principles, you are led directly to this sort of pattern, and ultimately, we will prevail. So this is that meeting 5 years ago that Bruce mentioned, but I want to lead into it where it took place in this room. This is Jerry Heindel, who's an officer of the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. I want to lead into this with a story. Shortly after Our Stolen Future was published, I would accept invitations from friend and foe. Friendly audiences, tough audiences. This one was tough. It was the Society of Plastics Engineers. These are people who make some of the materials that we were saying are likely to be a problem. How many of you know Camden, New Jersey? I grew up on the East Coast near there for a while at a time when Camden, New Jersey was where if they didn't like you, you had cement overshoes. Okay? So here it is. It's a dark and stormy night. I do my talk, confrontational. It's over. Everyone leaves as I'm packing up my early version of PowerPoint, except for two big guys in the back of the room. I was physically afraid as they began to walk toward me. They came up and they said, "Dr. Myers, we like what you're doing." Excuse me? "No, we like what you're doing. You're making certain commodities, plastics, unsellable in the market. And we've got the replacements. And we're going to make a lot of money." Now, I had never thought of this that way. I went to Reed College. I went to Berkeley. You can imagine where that puts me on the political spectrum. This was all about using forces of the marketplace to reward entrepreneurs to make different decisions about the materials they were using. It took me a while to really begin to work on this. It took Karen O'Brien and Paul Anastas and others to sort of drag me unwillingly into this perspective. But once I understood what this might be able to do, I realized we definitely need regulations. We need all that work. It's really hard. It's really important. But we also have to have another play because this takes too long. There are too many chemicals out there to deal with them one at a time. Why not think with the chemists early on in the design process, help them design new materials that are inherently safer and make money in the process? So we started this thing here. Jerry Heindel was one of the speakers. Bruce was one of the speakers. We had about, 30 people here for that meeting. Held over the last 5 years a series of meetings around the world trying to help them develop a common vision of what this future can look like. How can we do this? We had some great fun. We went to a place called Cavallo Point, just north of San Francisco Bay, and we brought them all into this big room. They didn't know what was happening other than that they had seen the agenda, some of which was blank. We brought them into the room. We gave them aprons with their names on them. We pulled the curtains back, and there were gourmet chefs who spent the next 2 hours teaching them how to make gourmet appetizers. So there's Jerry Heindel, the same guy who was speaking from the lectern, a health scientist, John Warner, who's one of the most famous green chemists in the world, also Terry Collins. There's Bruce Blumberg, applying his biological dissection skills to making delicious appetizers. And this is a guy from the UK, a German named Andreas Kortenkamp, who's one of the world's experts on how mixtures of chemicals interact. And this, let me recommend, if you ever need to have an icebreaker that gets people who don't know how to talk together, talking together, have them make food together. It was an extraordinary event. So we've been working on this. We're not done. We've got a paper in review that I think is going to be as important as that low-dose review thing that we just published. What we've done is developed what we're calling a tiered endocrine disruptor protocol for chemists to use if they want to. It's voluntary. It's not regulatory. If you're a chemist and you want to avoid endocrine disruption, we can help you figure out how to do that. And let me tell you, when we got regulation and politics out of the kitchen, it was so much easier to find solutions. So much easier, because the vested interests that have forestalled progress at the EPA for the last 15 years weren't present. All of a sudden, we had chemists wanting help and experts being able to provide it to them. It's not about current replacements. You know, if you think you can solve this problem by, say, taking that compound I mentioned, bisphenol A, and looking for something, is it on the shelf today? Well, anything that was on the shelf today was designed using the same flawed criteria that led to widespread use of bisphenol A. We're talking about the next generation of inherently safer materials. We think this is a process that will be inherently economically efficient. And I was speaking this morning to a group of people at the American Chemical Society, including someone from DuPont and someone from several people from different chemical companies, about this. And they really responded very positively, because what this helps them do early in the process, as they are starting to tinker with the molecules, they can say, oops, that's a no-no. I'm just not even going to waste more time and energy on that one, and I'll go and work on something else. Or they'll say, well, I can see the reason why that one is causing problems is because its molecular conformation looks like estrogen, and maybe I can tweak the bonds a little bit so I still have the material characteristics I want. It does what I need, but it can't bind with the estrogen receptor anymore. It's driven by principles out of endocrinology. It's informed by them, and so you actually can use that science to make wise decisions. And it's designed to evolve with the science. I didn't go into this, but the regulatory processes that we depend upon today often are using assays that are 30, 40, 50 years old. They don't reflect modern molecular genetics. They get locked into place, and they are the ones that dominate those regulatory decisions. Whatever we do here, we want it to reflect modern science and have a mechanism that can keep it evolving as the science changes, because the science will change. Here's our team, green chemists there, the endocrine disruptor folks there. People in both fields will recognize that the list includes world leadership from both these communities, world leadership. We've done some thought experiments with this. We chose some of the high-profile chemicals that are in great debate today in the news, the bisphenol A, atrazine, the perfluorinated compounds, the phthalates, organotins, perchlorate. And we asked in the literature, are there examples where any one of those would have been dinged by the sort of approach we are taking? And the answer is they all would have been dinged. So I asked you a series of questions at the outset about what your family and your friends are experiencing. These are today's epidemics. And for each of these conditions, there are data in the peer-reviewed scientific literature linking them to the effects of exposure to endocrine-disrupting compounds. Now, I'm not saying we know for certain that that's the case. In fact, I'm pretty confident that when you look at that list, as science moves forward, some will be taken off. But for others, there'll be increasing and increasing certainty. And I am convinced that by doing the things that we've been talking about this evening, both informing the regulatory process so that it reflects modern science, and helping chemists develop an inherently safer generation of new materials, I am convinced that over time, as we move forward and implement this, we can have material impacts on the frequency of these health conditions, and that would be a very good thing. Thank you very much. I would be happy to answer questions.
I wonder if you can comment on that. How do you reconcile this environmental health issues along with the economics, progress, business, political?
Yeah, that's a great question. And green chemists will tell you they aren't successful unless the materials they develop are economically competitive. I spent several days in Mumbai in December at an industrial green chemistry conference. And the reason why the room was full of industrial chemists from India, from around the country, was because they are facing changing world standards on what can be imported into Europe. Europe is moving very rapidly to increase the strength of the chemical standards they have. And unless you can meet those standards, you won't be able to import into Europe. That provides a huge economic incentive for chemical companies around the world who want access to that market to start paying attention to this type of analysis. Another way to look at this, the reason why Europe, one of the big reasons why Europe passed these laws that are gradually coming into effect, is they did some economic analyses of the health, of the economic costs of the health burden plausibly caused by some of these chemicals. And if you think about health insurance, and you know about the European system, the governments pay for health insurance. So their analysis was, yeah, there are economic costs of imposing these standards, but the benefits we get back by avoided healthcare costs are significantly bigger. So it works for them economically. Now in this system, and it works there because the healthcare costs are borne by the government, whereas here, healthcare costs are borne by all of us. They're externalized by the producers so that there isn't quite the same economic argument that can be made by the government for justifying some of these standards. India and China are putting much more resources into the intellectual capital of green chemistry. They want the intellectual property that's associated with it, which is developing quite rapidly now because this science is starting to really take off. They know that the intellectual capital, the intellectual property of traditional chemistry, it's been around for a long time. There aren't a lot of big breakthroughs that are going to happen. There are big breakthroughs that are going to happen in green chemistry as we get better and better at mimicking how nature does chemical reactions, that which is ultimately the goal. Room temperature, ambient pressure, non-toxic materials. That's how nature works. And so the general direction of this field is toward those types of things, but there are a lot of patents that are out there that haven't been seized yet because they haven't figured out how to do it. They will.
The EPA announced withdrawal of, I don't know, $20 million from
$20 million.
Yeah, green chemistry, and some of us were baffled by it. Do you have any insight into what happened?
Well, you may not know that EPA's official Twitter feed this afternoon announced that they were very likely to restore the funding. It isn't certain yet. It came out, what time? We were about 2. It was their Twitter feed. It wasn't on their website yet. This is our government doing what? But it's true. 2 days ago, they said, we are shutting it down. They did indicate when they said that, that they may open it up back again. And it appears that they're doing that.
It seems to be world security, terrorism, those fears. They have huge financial packages addressing those issues. This would seem to be a criteria for efficient systems.
This would seem to be, excuse me?
This is a criteria. Green chemistry is a criteria. Without it, they have no security.
I think that, how many of you have heard of Amory Lovins? So Amory, you know what made Amory famous initially was this 1976 article about changing course, about how the cheapest form of new energy is conservation. And when he said that, all the professional energy specialists laughed at him. And he said, "You're kidding. We just need to drill better, drill deeper, drill farther, drill in more places." Well, 40 years of energy history show us that Amory was right. It has proven to be the cheapest form of new energy. So why do I mention that? I think this is the cheapest form of healthcare savings. There are huge savings. It's once obesity and type 2 diabetes and heart disease made it onto this list? Those are the biggest health burdens we face economically and also socially. So the numbers are getting bigger and bigger, but the economists haven't figured out how to translate what we know scientifically into what they're willing to accept economically. But I am confident that this offers enormous potential for saving healthcare costs. Well, thank you. It's been a pleasure, a lot of fun.